let's talk a little bit more about this row buffer management. Okay, so let's first understand what are the differences between a row buffer hit versus a row buffer miss. Okay, so here's my array, and when I need to access a row, I essentially activate the word line, and all the cells that are sitting in this row then basically place their data onto what are called bit lines. So this is your word line, and this is your bit line. Okay, and at the bottom is the sense amplifier circuit, which doubles up as the row buffer as well. Okay, so let me just kind of focus in on what's going on over here. Right, so if you look at a cell, so here's a cell that stores either a 0 or a 1. This cell is connected to two different bit lines. Okay, so at the start, both of these bit lines are at some intermediate voltage, let's say 0.5 volts. Okay, and based on the value that is stored in the cell, one of these bit lines starts going towards a 1 voltage, and one of these bit lines starts going towards a 0 voltage. Okay, and so they start to diverge based on what is the cell content. If the cell content is the opposite, then the opposite bit line goes towards the 1 versus the 0. And at the bottom is the sense amplifier circuit, which starts to sense this divergence in the signal and tries to amplify it. So before those wires go all the way to a 1 or a 0, this sense amplifier circuit says that, oh, I've already detected what is going on. It looks like the value being stored is either a 1 or a 0. Okay, so this is how one cell gets read out, or the value stored in a cell gets read out, gets placed on the bit lines, and then gets sensed by the sense amplifiers at the bottom. Okay, so once you've brought things into the sense amplifier, feeding the signal back to the CPU takes less time. Okay, so let me draw another figure over here. This is my DRAM chip. Okay, and what I'm showing you over here is one array. So that's one small portion over here. Okay, so when you read stuff in the array, it gets placed in the row buffer that is directly below. And if you are accessing data that's already sitting in the row buffer, that takes less time because all you're doing is sending this data to the output pins, and then this gets placed on the memory bus. Okay, so this transfer is very slow. It takes about 20 nanoseconds. Okay, so a row buffer hit takes roughly 20 nanoseconds worth of time. Okay, now the next option is an empty row access. Okay, so if you assume that the bit lines have already been pre-charged to this 0.5 volt value. Okay, so when they are pre-charged, when both the bit lines have an equal value, the row buffers basically contain nothing. Okay, so now when I say that here's a certain row that I'm interested in, that word line gets activated, and the data then the bit lines start to diverge, and the sense amplifier detects that signal. That entire process takes about 20 nanoseconds. Okay, so to go from the pre-charged bit lines to a value being produced over here, that takes about 20 nanoseconds. So if you're accessing an empty row, the total delay will be 40 nanoseconds. 20 nanoseconds to bring data into the row buffer, and an additional 20 nanoseconds to move the data from the row buffer to the output pins. The third option is a row buffer conflict. When the row buffer currently contains some row X, and you're trying to read a different row Y. So before you can read a different row Y, you have to first take the bit lines back to this 0.5 volt value. Okay, and that's the pre-charge process. So when you do a pre-charge, you're essentially destroying the contents of the row buffer and saying that I'm going to bring these bit lines back to an equal voltage, and that gets me ready to access a new row. Okay, and that pre-charge process also takes roughly 20 nanoseconds. Okay, so it takes 20 nanoseconds to first do the pre-charge, and that is destroy the contents of the row buffer. Then you spend an extra 20 nanoseconds reading the new row into the row buffer, and then you spend an extra 20 nanoseconds moving the data from the row buffer to the output pins. Okay, so that takes 60 nanoseconds. So your memory access time is going to be a function of whether you find an empty row, or whether there's a row buffer conflict, or whether there's a row buffer hit. All right, and in addition to this delay, you also spend delay in other parts of the memory system. So you have to spend some time, moving the data from the output pins, back on this memory channel. And as I said earlier, it takes about 4 cycles to do that transfer. It also takes a few cycles to transfer the address and the command and so on. Okay, so there's about 10 nanoseconds worth of delay to transfer all of this data across the bus. And Very often when you arrive at the memory controller, there are other requests perhaps ahead of you. So there's also queuing delay that gets added on. So once all of these are considered, it is not unusual to take 100 nanoseconds to service one request from the memory system. And on a 3 GHz processor, that 100 nanosecond delay corresponds to about 300 cycles. Okay, so now that we've understood how the row buffer is managed, this also leads to what the memory controller does to manage these row buffers. Okay, so note that memory devices are completely dumb. They don't have any intelligence in them. All they do is store the data, and when you make a request for a row, it provides that corresponding cache line on the output pins. Okay, but there's really no intelligence on the memory chips itself, so all the intelligence has to be on the memory controller. The memory controller is responsible for knowing what has been stored in the row buffers, how much time it takes to get various pieces of data out, how long of a gap I must introduce between consecutive commands, and so on. So the memory controller has to preserve all of these timing constraints and make sure that it issues requests at the right time. Okay, so one of the things it does is it manages this row buffer as well. Okay, so we've talked about how you can have three different kinds of row buffer accesses, and accordingly you may want to keep a row buffer open, or you may want to precharge it before you even make the access to a different row. Okay, so let's try to understand this in some more detail. Okay, so let's say that I just accessed row X, or let's say I access cache line in a given row X. If my next access is going to be to a neighboring cache line in the same row, so if I'm accessing X plus 1, then if I keep the row open, that is, if I once I've serviced the first cache line, if I leave the row as it is, then my access to the next neighboring cache line is fairly quick, right? That's going to be 20 nanoseconds. Okay, that's going to be a row buffer hit. But instead, if I were to make an access to a different cache line Y, then this is a row buffer conflict, right? So it takes me 60 nanoseconds to service this. Okay, and this is what is happening if I have an open page policy. So once I access a row, I just leave it open. The other option is for me to say that I expect that this application has little locality. So the probability of me accessing Y is much higher than me accessing X plus 1. So let me try to optimize my memory system so that I'm reducing the delay for a subsequent access to Y. So as soon as I service the request for X, what I do is I close the row, which means I precharge the bit lines and make it ready to access some other different cache line. Okay, so this is known as the close page policy, where as soon as I return cache line X, I'm precharging the bit lines and destroying the contents of the row buffer. So now if I access Y, a different row altogether, this becomes an empty row access. And that's only 40 nanoseconds. Okay, and likewise, if I were to access X plus 1, so if I do access some neighboring element, since this is again going to be an empty row access, this also takes 40 nanoseconds. Right? So a closed page policy is going to worsen behavior for an access pattern that has locality, because you go from 20 to 40, but it improves delay for an access pattern that is devoid of locality. So if you were going to access Y anyway, so you're better off precharging the bit lines early than waiting until you see this new access to Y. Okay, so those are two extreme policies for managing the row buffer, where in one case you service a request and then just leave the row buffer open. The other extreme is to close the row buffer after every single access. Okay, and based on how much locality you observe, one or the other will do better. Okay, so most commercial memory controller policies try to do something that is somewhere in between these two extremes, and those algorithms are usually not publicly known.